I'm telling these tears go and fall away, fall away. Oh, may the last one burn into flames.
What is up, Wisconsin? I'm Maggie Dawn. You are listening to the Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. It's a beautiful Wednesday. Hope things are well where you are. We're coming to you live from downtown Waukesha, the WAUK. I've got Brian with me today. And boy, folks, do we have some terrific guests for you. You are not going to want to miss any of it today, I would say. We've got not only chair of the Wisconsin Democratic Party, Ben Wickler. We'll talk about yesterday's primary, the constitutional referendum vote that went down, as well as gearing up for the DNC next week. The big announcement that Vice President Harris is going to actually be in Milwaukee during the DNC, going to have a rally at the Fiserv on Tuesday. I'm like, hey, Brian, I might have to come back from Chicago for that one.
No problem there. I'll go.
Right? If I can't make it to that, my heart will literally break. But we'll talk about all that with Ben. Can't wait to do that. We also have two very, very special guests. Really excited to share with you all. I'm going to be joined by Dr. Danielle Carnival. She's a deputy assistant to President Biden. Her focus in advising the president is on the program that is called Cancer Moonshot. Big announcement today from the Biden-Harris administration. We're going to be joined by Dr. Carnival at the bottom of the hour to talk about that. We're also going to be joined in this hour by Kirabo Jackson. He is a member of the White House Council on Economic Advisors. We're going to be talking about the state of inflation and what's going on with business starts in the country and how we have recovered and continue to recover under the leadership of President Biden and Vice President Harris. So don't go anywhere. Got a stacked show. But I wanted to start with some pretty fabulous news. Pretty good. Pretty, pretty good news, I would have to say. You all may remember the guy by the name of Nate Silver. Nate Silver, if the name rings a faint bell, my friends, it is because Nate Silver is considered sort of the guru of polling statistics, a sensei of statistics, if you will. And he now publishes these results not through 538, but rather through a Substack called Silver Bulletin. Of course, yours truly subscribes. And he had some pretty good news yesterday. He came out with an update on all of the numbers on the Trump-Harris matchup. And ladies and gentlemen, they're damn good. So I wanted to start with some good news here to kick off the show. If you want to join the conversation, get in on this, please feel free to call or text 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. How are you feeling about the Trump-Harris matchup? Do you feel the excitement? Do you feel like the vice president's pulling ahead? Because that's what it looks like Nate Silver has concluded. Again, he uses much of the same methodology that he employed and developed for 538. And again, I'm not going to get into all of that because, listen, generally you don't do math on the radio and you certainly do not try to explain statistical methodology on the radio because it would be a little boring. But let me share you basically what the bottom line here is. Again, this is Nate Silver and his Substack Silver Bulletin coming out yesterday afternoon. Nationally, in the head-to-head contest, including Kennedy, RFK, including RFK Jr. in the mix, it shows Harris at 46.8% and Donald Trump at 43.7%. Wow. Wow. And the most encouraging piece of this isn't just that comparison. It's that Harris is up a full percentage point over last week, and nearly seven percentage points from a month ago. That's how fast Vice President Harris is surging up the polls. I don't know about you, Brian, but boy, that sure makes me feel good.
I'm pretty excited. I mean, like I judge a lot of things, but reading the tea leaves and stuff, like I can tell when a movie really wants to get seen because They need to make their money back because they're, you have to see this movie. You know, they're very desperate in things like that. So when I see different ad packages and things like that, that's how I read my tea leaves. And judging on the ad packages that have been released since Harris has become the nominee, they have one, and it's Border Czar. And they play that every 10 or 15 minutes ad nauseum. And it's not even a good ad either. Like, it's not even, like objectively speaking, good for anything whatsoever. But Harris has, 15 new ads and a new really one good every ads. Week.
Absolutely. There's two versions of the attack ads you're seeing from the Trump side of the fence. One is just with the gloomy voiceover, right? Oh, the borders are. And then the other one has, basically a fake cowboy border guy. That one's the one that
that's
is
my favorite.
Totally ridiculous.
Hey,
he doesn't watch this ad when it comes on. People, don't turn the channel. Do not mute. Look at it carefully. It's the one with the dude in the cowboy hat, and he's got some stupid title like the Border Patrol Group that likes the border guys and likes guns and wears hats. It's that kind of an outfit. He's got this cowboy hat on. And you can see that it's all garbage in the ad, right? Because he's got this fake little badge on. I mean, the dude's not even a real guy. And they're like, oh yeah, let's go to TV with
this.
Looks ridiculous.
He's in front of a not finished border wall, and he's basically Gruber Law Offices makes better ads than this. It's like the guy could be selling you local siding. Like it's absolutely
it's bad.
Awful. Nobody wants to work with them, by the way. That's really kind of it. Nobody in the creative business wants to work with these people. And it'd be because I know people in the creative business. Their political spectrum is wide. There's a lot of people who are Trump voters that work on films with me. But they don't want to work on this.
No. You know who had better ads? It's Saul Goodman from Breaking Bad fame. And of course, his own show had better ads than that. It looks so stupid. Speaking of ads, we've got some of the sound from a Harris ad that dropped, I think, just yesterday or Sunday. Let's take a listen, Brian.
Kamala Harris has spent decades fighting violent crime. As a border state prosecutor, she took on drug cartels and jailed gang members for smuggling weapons and drugs across the border. As vice president, she backed the toughest border control bill in decades. And as president, she will hire thousands more border agents and crack down on fentanyl and human trafficking. Fixing the border is tough. So is Kamala Harris.
I'm Kamala Harris, and I approve this message.
I mean, that's the point, right? It's actual serious content. It's not, you know, hyperbolic ridiculousness. And the reason I say it's serious content is, one, because it's true. She did those things as a border state prosecutor and attorney general. In fact, there are a lot of liberals that criticize her for those very things. So it's interesting, you know, she gets criticized from both ends of the spectrum, right? From those on the far left and from those on the far right, which in my mind usually means you're getting it probably about right in the end. And listen, she supported the bipartisan immigration bill that Trump intentionally killed. It would have been the most restrictive, most aggressive immigration bill that this country's seen in over 25 years, and Trump killed it. If he was serious about border security and giving a toot about the lives of Americans, he would have told every single Republican in Congress to sign that thing. And then he would have explained to the American people how he would do even more. He would make that distinction. But Donald Trump can't handle anything under the microscope and can't talk about any policy to any degree of detail. So, of course, he didn't want that. But if Donald Trump actually cared about American people's lives, he would have told every Republican in Congress, both in the Senate and the House, to vote for that bill. And then he would have made a case to the American people about why it's not enough and what he wants to do in addition to that. But he doesn't really care. And so he told him to kill it. And his sycophants in Congress, just like Speaker Mike Johnson, and of course, the turtle, Mitch McConnell in the Senate did his bidding and killed, again, the most aggressive immigration bill that this country's seen in 25 years. And that bill, Kamala Harris supported. I love that people talk about, oh, well, Biden assigned her and made her the border czar, and she didn't get much done, did she? Yeah, she couldn't, because she can't do what the president won't let her do. And Biden was not ready to do what needed to be done on the border. He is subject to criticism on that. But when it came time to act, she threw her full weight behind the most aggressive immigration bill that this country has seen in 25 years. So, by the way, I mean, if people want to talk, oh, she was the border czar and didn't get it. The job of a vice president is to take the hardest assignments and take the shots for the president. And they also do not have any unilateral authority to do whatever they want on those things. Kamala Harris, just the same. She took one for Joe Biden by taking on that assignment. She had no ability to do anything that Biden wasn't going to support, and he wasn't ready to move until he put this immigration bill before Congress, which Trump killed. Trump killed the immigration bill.
And he could go and take credit for it. Say, I got this immigration bill passed, and then run on it. I might even go and respect the guy for doing something. I was ready to. Well,
you mean to be a man of principles instead of personal interest that puts policy over party, that does the right thing, even though it might not be the best for you, the individual? Yeah, Donald Trump ain't doing that ever. We all know that. CJ knows that. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be back. I'll share some more of the Nate Silver polling. There's good news, folks. I'm Maggie Dawn. He's Brian Kelly. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network.
Keep on running, cause the winner don't quit on themselves.
They want to get going, and they're going to get going.
What I'm going to do, the sun is shining. It's a beautiful day here in Wisconsin this Wednesday afternoon. My name is Maggie Dawn. He's Brian Kelly. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network. We come to you live from downtown Waukesha, but we go out statewide. If you don't know where to find your local Civic Media station, just go to civicmedia.us and check it out. You can also download the app and take us in your pocket wherever you go. And then you don't even need to worry about which Civic Media station is your local station. It is free from your favorite app store. I like this point coming in. Andrew from Maine. Hi, Andrew. Love to see you on the text line. He said, what did Mike Pence do to help secure the border? It doesn't seem to come up much, does it? It's weird. Weird. Does Mike Pence... He wasn't the pick for vice president, was he? No. They picked the guy that said he would violate his constitutional oath and just do whatever Trump wanted him to do. Yeah, that guy. Huh. But let's get back to the good news, shall we, Brian? Let's do some good news.
I like good news. That's fun.
I like good news, too. So, again, this is Nate Silver on his Substack now called The Silver Bulletin. Nate Silver of 538 fame, the website 538. He's basically the pontiff of polling, the sensei of statistics. This guy gets it right. He gets it right very frequently, and is quite adept at the accuracy, not just getting it right, but the margins, really down in the nitty gritty. So I was talking about the national polling averages that he puts together. Right now, Harris, according to Nate Silver's Silver Bullet Substack, leading Trump by a not insignificant margin, by 3.1%. Harris at 46.8%. Trump at 43.7%. Kennedy still included in the polling. He's at just under 4 at 3.9%. Again, that marks a 6.9% increase for Kamala Harris over a month ago. That is just huge. You do not see that kind of swing in that short of a period of time. So this is monumental. But let's break it down into the swing states, folks, where the action really is and where this race to the White House will be won or lost. Pennsylvania. She's leading Trump 46% to 43.9. That represents a 6% increase from a month ago for Kamala Harris. Michigan. 46.4% to Trump's 42.3%. That's an 8.6 increase. Holy, holy cow. Over a month ago. Georgia, 45.3% for Harris, 45.8% for Trump. You want to take a guess at how much that's up over a month, Brian? Just take a guess.
6.
10.5% increase. Jeez. Yes. That is, I mean, folks, you just don't see this at this late stage in a presidential race. You don't tend to see movements like this. That is an absolutely historic increase. That's in Georgia, up Kamala Harris, up 10.5% over where she was polling a month ago. Arizona. She's now leading Trump in Arizona. I just want that to sink in. According to Nate Silver, Silver Bullet, Kamala Harris now leading Trump in Arizona, razor thin, 45.1% to 44.1%. How much do you think she's up over a month ago in Arizona?
Arizona?
Yeah.
Man, that's a hard one because sometimes they, like, it depends on who shows up in Arizona, too. I'm getting people saying 11 points. 11 points.
She is up 11.8%. 11.8%.
11.8 in Arizona?
Over where she was a month ago in Arizona. Wow. This should be scaring the bejiggers out of every MAGA cult member. North Carolina, Trump still a slight lead. 45.4% to Harris, 46.5% to Trump. He doesn't have good polling averages from a month ago, so no change to point out there. But just over a week, just based on a week ago, Kamala Harris up a full point in North Carolina. Nevada. She's leading Trump in Nevada. That is new. 45.3%, 43.3%, 45 to 43. Harris v. Trump in Nevada. Again, no good polling averages from a month ago, but just over 1 week from a week ago, Harris is up 2.5%. I mean, that is just unbelievable. And folks, if you're screaming at your radio, what about Wisconsin, Maggie? I, of course, saved the best for last. Yes, Mr. Silver broke it down in Wisconsin, and here are the figures. According to Nate Silver's Silver Bullet, as of late yesterday, polling averages showing Harris at 47.4% in the great state of Wisconsin and Trump at 43.6%. This is a 6.1% increase over a month ago. And here's how much Kamala Harris moved in a week in the state of Wisconsin, according to Nate Silver, 2.6%.
Two in a week?
2.6 in a week. 2.5. Don't short her, right? Like 2.6% in a week. That's how much Kamala Harris is surging.
Like, as an outsider, it's
extraordinary.
As an outsider, I see Wisconsin as a conservative state overall in general, just as like in the general sense of I don't like change, but changing 2% over a week, that's huge.
Yep. So let's ask our favorite caller. CJ, are you as scared as you should be?
No, I'm not, because it's going to be like was it Dr. Charles Franklin, who you guys have on?
Yeah.
Said kind of like Mandela Barnes, when people find out the platform and her radical positions, they aren't going to want her. But you're doing a really good job, and she's doing a great job with a campaign, hiding just like Joe Biden. The only policies she's come out with, she stole from Donald Trump about no tax on tips.
But, which is the stupidest idea I have ever heard, and every economist agrees with me. That is dumb, dumb, dumb. If we want to worry about not taxing tips, what we need to do is change the entire tax code so that it is fair to working people and taxes billionaires and the wealthiest corporations more. I totally agree with you, CJ, on that.
Well, now Kamala disagrees with you, so...
Yeah, she does. She's wrong about that. I'll tell you when I think she's wrong. But calling Kamala Harris a radical when she spent the first 15 to 20 years of her career prosecuting criminals and locking bad guys up. I mean, most people don't call their local district attorney or their AG a radical lefty. You know, they're the law and order types. On the other hand, you got a convicted felon. Yeah. I think CJ is a little nervous. I think he is. Yeah, of course, polling is just a point of time, and there is lots of time between now and November 5th. We'll see what happens next. When we come back, I will be joined by Deputy Assistant to President Biden, Dr. Danielle Carnival. We're going to be talking about cancer moonshot and what Joe Biden and Kamala Harris are doing to bring an end to cancer. Stay tuned, everybody. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network.
Baby, yeah. Tell me that you like it, yeah.
Tell me something. Tell me nice. It's not nice. It's not good.
Welcome back, Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network, coming to you live from downtown Waukesha. Happy Wednesday, everybody. Really excited to have my next guest with me. Her name is Dr. Danielle Carnival. She's a deputy assistant to President Biden for the program Cancer Moonshot, which I had not even heard about until I started reading about the big announcement that the Biden-Harris campaign is making today. No better person to talk to about Project Cancer Moonshot than Dr. Carnival. Welcome to the show, Doctor. I really appreciate you making time. Tell folks, what is Project Cancer Moonshot?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you for having me. It's great to be here. And I'm excited that you now know what the Biden Cancer Moonshot is, and I'm happy to share it with your audience. The Biden Cancer Moonshot really started because cancer is personal to President Biden, to the First Lady. It's personal to me, it's personal to practically every American family. And so they started this initiative with really bold goals early on in the Biden-Harris administration to decrease the cancer death rate in the United States by at least half. That's preventing more than 4 million cancer deaths by 2047, and to improve the experience of people who are touched by cancer. We know how much it impacts families, and they want to do everything they can to boost support and get people back to survivorship and to living their best lives.
Yeah, I was most struck by the importance of not just trying to ensure that people can beat and survive cancer, but the importance of trying to make the experience of battling cancer for the patient and their families less awful. I have a couple of very close friends and family members that have died, and it was so difficult to watch their suffering. And a couple of my family members that have beat cancer, it was difficult to watch their suffering as they became survivors. So when we think about what that is and trying to help improve the technology and the practices to help prevent, detect, and treat cancer, what sort of level of investment has the Biden-Harris administration put into Project Cancer Moonshot?
Yeah, well, what you point out, Maggie, is that what's needed, especially to achieve these bold goals, is really effort across the board. So in the area of prevention, for example, The Environmental Protection Agency, as part of the bipartisan infrastructure law that people think of roads and bridges, put more than $4 billion into cleaning up toxic sites around the country that were usually located near underserved communities, helping prevent cancer in that way. It cleaned up water lines, including removing these so-called forever chemicals, PFAS, so that people aren't exposed to that and don't develop cancer. It's what we talked about yesterday. The president and first lady were down in New Orleans announcing $150 million in new awards from an agency that was created during the Biden-Harris administration called ARPA-H, an Advanced Research Projects Agency for Health. It's a lot of words, but what's really happening is putting out really bold calls around how do we make sure in this case that cancer surgeries are successful the first time, that people don't have to go in for multiple surgeries, and that all the cancer is removed. ARPA-H put out $150 million to 8 research teams across the country that are going to advance our way to see cancer cells inside a person during a surgery, or to see blood vessels and nerve cells or nerves so that the surgeon can avoid that. And then I want to go back to where you started, which is on the care side. Another example, really led by the First Lady, is for the first time ever, people can, as part of their insurance, get cancer navigation services paid for. This means you and your family have someone walking beside you, helping make decisions about the next step in your treatment or how to access financial services or get travel to get to the hospital, or whether or not you should participate in a clinical trial. So we're really investing across the board to make an impact on all Americans facing this disease.
That, I think, is absolutely revolutionary and so deeply needed. Everyone that I know that is close to me, and I bet many, many listeners out there, when that person I loved was battling cancer, it became a full-time job for people to help access care, arrange transportation, make adjustments to the home. Do they need a hospital bed? How are we going to pay for this? What does Medicare or Medicaid cover? What are our additional sources? That was as hard. The logistics of the battle against cancer was just as tough and exhausting for both the patient and their family as the battle against the disease itself was. So critically important. Just to emphasize again, that announcement today coming from the Biden-Harris administration, the president and the first lady are in New Orleans announcing this $150 million in federal dollars allocated by the administration to help support these precision surgical interventions, as well as these other assistance and resources to help families navigate their battle so that they can survive cancer. This is part of, if I'm looking at the right facts here, I want to be sure I get this right, Dr. Carnival, this is part of the already $400 million, or it's on top of the already invested $400 million to try to fast track treatment protocols and different high-tech interventions. So a significant investment from the Biden-Harris administration. Who are which universities are getting this new tranche of $150 million that's targeted at these precision surgical interventions and these other programs to help folks navigate their cancer fight?
Yeah, so this new agency that I talked about, it's a new way of really driving innovation in ways to prevent, detect, treat, and treat cancer and other diseases. So this is, ARPA-H is not just limited to cancer, but that $400 million is what ARPA-H has put into the fight to end cancer as we know it, which is really our mission at the Biden Cancer Moonshot. The awards that were announced as part of this precision surgical intervention program went to Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, Johns Hopkins University in Maryland, Rice University in Texas. We were down in Tulane in Louisiana, the University of California, San Francisco, University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, University of Washington, and a company called Cision Vision in California. But this is just part of what ARPA-H has built. They've also built a clinical trial network. So all of the innovations that they're driving on these great big ideas that we talked about, we want to make sure people have access to them through a clinical trial. And so they've built a nationwide clinical trial network so that not just the big cancer research institutions have these innovations, but communities and individuals all across the country.
Yeah, it's a really impressive commitment from the Biden-Harris administration. And I think where you started, Dr. Carnival, where you mentioned that really the Biden-Harris administration takes a whole of government approach to battling cancer, to improving the health of each and every one of our families. I think that is sets apart this administration. I personally haven't seen such attention and care and deliberateness about trying to break down the silos that oftentimes exist benignly, but nonetheless exist between the various departments that comprise the massive federal government, and understanding we have to mobilize the whole of government to deliver to Americans what they truly deserve in terms of these technological advances, treatment advances, and other support. I know that part of Cancer Moonshot is, again, these investments in precision in surgical interventions, these technological improvements for prevention, treatment, all these things. But this is part of a number of cancer-focused programs that the Biden-Harris administration has put together. Can you tell us a little bit about a few of the others?
Yeah, so we talked about navigation. We talked a little bit about prevention. And obviously, this is focused on innovation. But an area we haven't talked about that is critically important to achieving these goals is making sure that we detect cancer early when we know outcomes are best. And so when the Biden-Harris administration started and we reignited the Cancer Moonshot, we were just coming out of a pandemic where Americans missed nearly 10 million cancer screenings. And we set a goal to get back on track. And because of investment from the private sector, reaching 1 million people with cancer screenings over that time, we reached out to employers who have improved their access to cancer screening for their employees. They're really invested in making sure that their employees stay healthy and productive. And through federal investments, we've rebounded from what we missed early in the pandemic, and we're back on track. Now, that's not good enough. We want to make sure that everyone takes action themselves and talks to their doctor about what recommended screenings they should get, because if we can catch cancer early, we have a much better chance at success and making sure that people get back to their lives.
Well, and what I thought was incredibly important as a piece of this early detection effort was that they provided, meaning the Department of Health and Human Services under the Biden-Harris administration, applied or gave grants to create health centers specifically for cancer screenings in underserved communities. And I was like, oh, yes, of course. It seems so commonsensical, yet it's so critical. And it hadn't happened before. Absolutely central, certainly here in Milwaukee and in Wisconsin, COVID made plain, laid bare the health outcome disparities that we see in our communities and in our families. So trying to put these sorts of cancer screening centers in underserved communities, I thought was just critical.
Well, listen, national goals and as you said, a kind of whole of government effort around this is really important. But we know what you know, which is folks embedded in communities that understand those communities know best how to reach people with messages around prevention, around screening, around treatment. And so as much as we can work with those community organizations, Centers for Disease Control and Prevention does amazingly, and more broadly, the Department of Health and Human Services through these community health centers, we're making sure that these resources get into those communities where they can be delivered in a way that makes sense and really reaches people so that they can get access to the prevention, early detection, and care that they need.
And as one last example of that, I was also incredibly touched given Wisconsin's history. We are a land that is rich in our First Nation people. We have a lot of First Nation folks here in the state of Wisconsin, and the Biden and Harris administration trying to change the rules so that folks accessing healthcare from tribal reservation lands can get the best drugs available if they are on Medicare. I just thought that was, again, essential in targeting traditionally underserved communities. My guest this segment has been Dr. Danielle Carnival. Yep, go ahead.
I was going to say, for far too long, people have had to travel really long distances, and there's great care that can be provided much closer to tribal lands and on through the Indian Health Service. And so we want to make sure that they can get really good cancer care too. Sorry about that.
No, not at all. It's essential. I'm so glad to see attention finally being directed by the Biden-Harris administration. I think a lot of these issues and these communities were completely ignored under the prior MAGA administration. My words, not hers. My guest this half hour, the fabulous Dr. Danielle Carnival, Deputy Assistant to President Biden for Cancer Moonshot. Thanks so much for being here, Doctor. Hope to talk to you again soon. Keep up the great work.
Thank you.
I'm Maggie Dawn, folks. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network. We're going to take a couple of quick messages and come right back with Kirabo Jackson, who's on the President's Council of Economic Advisor. We're going to talk inflation and about business starts. Some great news, more good news, folks, on this Wednesday edition of the Maggie Dawn Show. Keep it locked.
Can't buy me
welcome back, Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Dawn. He's Brian Kelly. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network. We are hoping to be joined shortly by Kirabo Jackson.
I'm here.
Hello. I thought you were going to be calling in, but it's great to see Hi, great to have you. Wonderful. Well, then, without further ado, we've got Dr. Kirabo Jackson joining us. He is a member of the White House Council of Economic Advisors. Really happy to have you here because people keep talking about it. Inflation, inflation, inflation. It seems to be all that gets discussed these days. And it's complicated, isn't it? So much going on. I just was asked by a journalist from Forbes to explain what's going on with inflation. And they wanted like three or four sentences. And I sort of chuckled and went, here's 1,000 words, right? There has been, I think, some really encouraging news. We've seen some cooling off in the economy. That means the Fed hopefully will be in a place where we're going to start to see them actually bringing interest rates down. That's generally good in the short term for consumers. But we also got really good news from President Biden and his Bureau of Labor Statistics about new business applications. Tell us what's going on, Dr. Jackson, because people want to know.
It's a great question. So first, I always want to like lay that foundation and make clear that, you know, when we looked at where the economy was, say, 2 years ago, the expectation then was, you know, we sort of had inflation that was due to the supply chain issues. We had a war with Ukraine, and we had inflation that was somewhere in the highs of like 9%. And the prediction there was that there was no way we're going to bring the inflation rate down, have disinflation to levels consistent with stable, steady growth that the Fed wants to see. That's somewhere around 2 or 3% without plunging the economy into a deep recession. And as you rightly point out, that never happened. Basically, this economy, under the stewardship of President Biden and Vice President Harris, has surpassed expectations, and we've managed to bring inflation down considerably off its peak. We're now seeing prints, as you rightly point out, that are really consistent with the kinds of things we saw before the pandemic. We're seeing price growth that is pretty stable, and at the same time, we have not gone into a deep recession. On the contrary, we've had a very, very strong economy. We've seen unemployment has been at record lows for a long period of time. We've had record numbers of basically new businesses being created, which you highlighted, which is really an indication of overall dynamism in the economy. So you pointed out that we've had, under this administration, we've added about 19 million new business applications, which, you know, if you think about it, you know, President Biden often says that starting a business is an act of hope. And what we're seeing is we have 9 million acts of hope that have happened under this administration. And this is really an indication of the fact that this administration has invested in this economy, has made sure that it is resilient, and that when we came out of this economy, when we came out of the recovery associated with COVID, we came out strong. If you compare the amount of GDP growth we've had in this country compared to what they're seeing in, say, Europe, we've grown about twice as much as they have. So we've done very, very well by international standards, by most measures. So things are doing very, very well. The last thing I just want to highlight is you sort of mentioned prices and inflation and the fact that everyone's talking about it. And it's really helpful to think about this in the context of what a healthy economy looks like. When you have a healthy economy that's really growing and adding jobs as the economy has been doing, you tend to have a little bit of inflation. You tend to see prices go up a little bit. Think of it as like heat that is given off from your car. That's sort of an indication that your economy is alive and is growing. But you don't want inflation to be too high. You don't want prices to go too rapidly. What you want is you want the economy to be adding jobs. You want it to be adding to the quality of life by having wages grow faster than prices. And generally speaking, we want wage growth to outpace price growth, which we typically see. And what happened right around 2022, when we had all these supply chain issues, y'all remember the ship stuck in the canal, all those things.
Yep.
Price growth really jumped up. Inflation jumped up. And it's taken a while for wage growth to catch up, but it actually has. So one of the things we've seen is if you look for the majority of workers who are in sort of like middle and low earning jobs, wage growth has outpaced price growth for about 17 or 18 months. So it's been a long time this has been happening. And if you do a calculation, we do this sometimes at the council, we calculate how many hours one has to work to buy 1 week's worth of groceries. Just sort of bring this down to people. It is certainly true that the number of hours went up quite a bit during 2021-22, but we're now back down to levels that we saw before the pandemic, which is to say people's paychecks are going farther than they were before the pandemic. And this is really due to the fact that we've been able to, with the guidance of President Biden, bring the economy under control. We've got inflation under control. We've got wage growth, which is positive. And overall, this is indicative of a growing economy and stable, steady growth. And this is also consistent with the fact that we have a whole large number of new businesses starting out because they know that this is a good economy. It's a good place to earn money.
All of that and a bag of chips, as the kids say, Dr. Jackson. I just wanted to highlight a couple of things here, which I think is really important. We know that inflation in 21, right after President Biden was sworn in, went up precipitously in a very short period of time. I wanted you to just briefly address, listen, it doesn't work like that. It's not Joe Biden gets into office and as a result, he causes inflation to spike. It was all of these, the table setting that had happened under the Trump administration, as well as COVID, right? And the supply chain disruptions as a result of that drove inflation hitting nearly 9%. And as of this week, inflation is back down below 3%, no recession. That is a victory of victories. The Wall Street Journal even has acknowledged as much, even on its op-ed pages. Explain to people, it doesn't work like Joe Biden takes office in January and by June inflation is high and that's Joe Biden's fault. Just explain that to people.
No, you're absolutely right. You know, President Biden inherited an economy that was headed towards exactly what you described. When he came into office, unemployment was already very, very low. If you recall, the economy had not reopened. And you think about it, I think people sometimes don't even want to think about that time because it was such an unpleasant period to live through. But if you go back to that period, you remember a lot of things were shut down. The economy in China was shut down. So a lot of the countries that were supplying the things that we needed were shut down. So a good example of that is we couldn't actually get cars in this country in 2021 because a lot of cars had microchips that were used in the engines. And the microchips were produced in China and they shut down production. So we couldn't actually get the chips to basically sell the cars. And that led to basically we didn't have enough cars to go around and then the price of cars goes up. So unsnarling supply chains was something that President Biden did as soon as he came into office. He put in a supply chain stability task force to unsnarl those supply chains, and that basically brought prices down. To continue,
I gotta jump in. So sorry, Dr. Jackson. I hope you come back sometime. I'm an economist. We can chop it up for hours, I would think. Gotta go to break.
Thank you so much.
I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to the Civic Media Radio Network. News, weather, and sports are next.